In the previous video, we took a look at a couple of IATA standards. We saw how we could wire up an RJ45 connector. And we said that primarily we're going to be using the T568B standard. And here we see a reminder of how the pins are laid out in an RJ45 connector and what wires connect to which pins. But when we're actually connecting these RJ45 connectors into network devices like PCs or switches or routers, let's see how the data actually flows over these wires. For example, let's consider a 10 base T network or a 100 base TX network. You might remember that those two types of networks, they only use two pairs to carry the data. We've got a transmit pair and we've got a receive pair. The transmit pair coming from the PC is made up of pins 1 and 2. The receive pair is made up of pins 3 and 6. Now, if I'm sending from something like a PC or even a router, that interface that I'm plugging my RJ45 connector into is called an MDI, a media dependent interface. And if I'm plugging into a switch or a hub, that port by default is going to be a media dependent interface crossover or an MDIX. Notice how this works. The role of the pins on an MDIX device like a switch, they're different than we have on the MDI device. After all, if I was connecting a PC into a PC, we would not want the transmit signal coming from PC1 to go into the transmit pins of PC2. No, we want to receive a transmission on the other end. So the receive and the transmit, they need to touch one another. In fact, they even have polarity. Notice what happens here. On pin 1 for the MDI device, we've got a T+, a positive polarity. It's connecting to the R+, the receive pin over on the MDIX device. T- connects to R-, R+ connects to T+, R- connects to T-. So the receive pair on one end goes to the transmit pair on the other end, and the transmit pair on one end goes to the receive pair on the other end. That's how we can have communication when we're using these two pairs. However, let's say that we had a couple of PCs and we wanted to hook those back to back, or maybe a couple of switches and we wanted to hook those back to back. They would have the same pinout on each end. Suddenly, we've got transmit on one end going to transmit on the other end. So what do we do in a case like that? Well, one option is to use a crossover cable. What we see on screen right now is a straight through cable, where pin 1 on one RJ45 connector shows up on pin 1 on the RJ45 connector at the other end of the cable. But now here's how we would have a crossover cable. We simply have to take the two transmit pins, and instead of just going straight over to the receive pins on an MDIX connector, we have to go down to pins 3 and 6. You see, T+ still maps to R+. But since the pins are a mirror image of each other, that means the individual wires are not going to look the same on one end of the cable as the other. In other words, the white-orange wire on one RJ45 connector is going to show up on pin 1, but if you look at the other end of a crossover cable, that white-orange wire is going to show up on pin 3. And for your reference, this is what a crossover cable would look like if we're dealing with 10 base T or 100 base TX, because they only use two pairs of wires for the data. However, let's bump the speed up a little bit. Let's say that we're going to move up to a gigabit. We're using 1000 base T. Here, we're using all 8 pins, not just 2 pair. We're using all 4 pairs. And instead of just having one transmit pair and one receive pair, we've got data A and data B and data C and data D. And each of those have polarities. So DA+, that's data A positive. DA-, that's data A negative. And you can see that with a straight through cable, if we're going from an MDI device like a PC to an MDIX device like a switch, the DAs map to the DBs. So DA+ goes to DB+, DA- goes to DB-. So A's and B's, they map to one another. C's and D's, they map to one another as well. And everything is great with the straight through cable if we have one side of the cable connected to an MDI device and the other side of the cable connected to an MDIX device. However, what if we hook a couple of PCs back to back and we want to communicate between those PCs at gig speeds? If we need a crossover cable, here's what that would look like. Again, if both devices are MDI, that means the pinouts are the same on both sides. That means that we have to cross some wires over as we go from one side of the cable to the other side of the cable, because the DAs, they need to map to the DBs, and the DCs, they need to map to the DDs, and so on. So as an example here, we can see that pin 1 on one of our MDI devices, that's DA+, it's going to map to DB+, pin 3 on the other side. So the thing I would want you to know is a crossover cable is appropriate when we're interconnecting like devices. So a router to a router, a switch to a switch, a hub to a switch, a hub to a hub, a PC to a PC. Now, by the way, typically a PC and a router, they're both MDI devices. It's the switches and the hubs that are MDI-X devices. But here's the good news. For the real world, a lot of today's devices, most of the switches that I'm buying these days, they have something called auto MDI-X built into them. In other words, instead of having to make up these crossover cables or purchase these crossover cables, the pins can detect which pins need to be filling which roles. So if the pins need to switch over from an MDI-X configuration to an MDI configuration, they can do that dynamically. So most of the time, in fact, it's been quite some time since I had to use a crossover cable, most of the time I can use a straight-through cable for everything. I can connect a switch to a switch using a straight-through cable because most of those modern switches, they will do auto MDI-X.